Okay, and the Oscar goes to Searching for Sugar Man.
The thing with Sugar Man was that the story almost sounds like it's fiction. Yeah. It's almost like if it would have been fiction, it wouldn't really have worked, because if a fiction story is unbelievable, you don't just buy the concept. It's like, this is unbelievable, it's ridiculous. But if the good thing was with the truth is that the truth can actually be unbelievable.
Yeah. Was it a huntsman or a player that made you pay the cost, that now assumes relaxed positions and prostitutes your loss? Were you tortured?
All right, I am here interviewing Oscar-winning director, producer from one of the best documentaries I've personally ever seen, Searching for Sugar Man. Now, Malik, how do I say your surname?
You would say Bendjelloul.
Bendjelloul, but now that sounds Italian.
Yes, it could be Italian, but it's not. It's actually African. My father is from Algeria.
This is your first movie.
It is my first movie.
You got an Oscar for your first movie. Not even Steven Spielberg can say that.
No.
Martin Scorsese can't say that.
That's probably true. Yeah.
Is that the first thing on your CV, on your bio? It says Oscar winning.
I'm sure it's going to be like that forever.
It is such a unique story. What's so unique about it is, as a South African, I know about the history of Rodriguez. I know how it affected my personal life growing up as a school kid, as a student. We listened to his music. It spoke to our lives. It spoke to our situation in our political climate. His music really was personal to us. And then when we as South Africans found out that it was only us, that this man wasn't a superstar on planet Earth, as your documentary points out, you know, we were quite amazed by this. When did you first hear about this story?
I heard about the story in 2006. I hadn't heard the music first. To be honest, I didn't really care about the music first, because the way I heard the story was through the South Africans, Craig and Sugar, down in Cape Town. And they told me this story, and I thought personally it was the best story I had ever heard. But then they said that this guy is as good as Bob Dylan. And then I was
some
like,
say better.
Or even better. And then I was like, yeah, sure.
Silver magic ships you carry, jumpers, coke, sweet Mary Jane.
Sugar. So I was like, better not listen to this music, because I'm going to be severely disappointed. Of course, I mean, the comparisons were outrageous. They compared him to, you know, being the greatest songwriters
of all time.
And it was only when I walked out in the streets of Cape Town and Johannesburg and asked people randomly, do you actually know this guy, Rodriguez? I never heard about him. And they were like, what do you mean? They were like questioning, what do you mean? They thought I was joking.
Yeah.
It was candid camera. What do you mean you never heard about Rodriguez? And then I realized that this is true. He is a household name here. And then I started to listen to and everyone said also that he was as good as the great ones. And then I was like, I started to listen to those songs, and I was, holy smoke, this is enough to make a documentary, like a lost masterpiece, which deserves a story. But in the reason why I made this film was there was so much more. It was also this detective story. It was also the resurrection of a dead man. They really, really thought that Rodriguez was dead, or you, many South Africans really thought that.
I did. Until I started hearing the hype of the movie, I had believed in all the urban legends.
Still?
That, yes, absolutely. Up until about 3-4 years ago.
Oh, wow.
I still believed, and I wasn't sure which story to believe, the one where he'd committed suicide on stage, or the one where he'd done it after a show, or that he was murdered in a bar. There were so many stories going around.
Every time I hear this, I'm still amazed by it, that so many people actually had this.
Well, the thing is, we have such a connection with him, and then he just disappeared. Now that brings us to the one thing that your documentary really brings to light, and I suppose in Rodriguez's behavior post the documentary, he really is a recluse in the sense of the word. He shies away from interviews, he hates talking about himself. How did you eventually get what you did out of him for the movie?
Well, it wasn't hard. It's very double, because he wasn't hard to get to. He liked sitting in cafes talking for a lot. He's not a silent man. It's not a man of few words, actually.
Oh,
which
really?
You might think when you, because the thing is, he doesn't like to talk about himself.
Yes.
And in an interview with him about in the film that is about him, you like him to speak about himself.
Yes.
And he doesn't like that. He thinks he has nothing to say. But in all other areas, he has plenty to say and has a lot of ideas. And it's super nice guy to talk to, actually. Speaking to him is really like one of them. I prefer to speak to him than to many of my friends. You learn more. It's a more awake mind. He's got a very, very, you know, he's a very super creative guy.
Yes.
Creative guys often.
Well, if you just look at his lyrics, you can see.
Yeah. They think in a bigger way, and he really thinks in a bigger way, which is very, very, very interesting to listen to.
But I can't believe there is a single South African that hasn't seen it yet, and you just do the story and the ethos of it and the South African story of it so much justice. A lot of people make the mistake of believing when they see the documentary that it's shot by a South African.
Yeah, which is interesting. Why didn't a South African make it? Because it's your story, really, and you knew this story. Here comes the dolphins, right?
Yes, here comes the dolphins.
And you knew.
The mayor hides the crime rate. Councilwoman hesitates. Public gets irate, but forgets the vote date. Weatherman complaining.
Document things that are South African so well. And Gambit is one of the most famous dolphins in the world because he's one of the biggest in captivity, he's one of the oldest in captivity, he's one of the most friendly, he's one of the most intelligent, but that's a default of South African creatures.
I'm sorry. I mean,
that's a And so, I just thought that. But I just thought, you know.
I'm very grateful.
Woke out this morning with a ache in my head. I flashed on my clothes and I spilled out of bed. I opened the window to listen.
You're in Africa.
Yeah.
So you must be here for a reason. I'm just trying to think, what's the next story? You obviously can't tell us, but I'm hoping it's a uniquely South African story.
Right. Well, after the film, I was. You pretty much, you're approached by a lot of like people who want you to make direct stuff, like mostly fiction stuff, because that's where there's an industry. There's a thing called director for hire. You hire a director to direct some script that you want to do if you're a Hollywood producer. And I did get approached by those ideas, and maybe I'm going to do that because some of those scripts might be really good. But right now I'm thinking about doing it the same way I did Sugarman, to actually start with going out. Looking for stories, traveling around.
Yeah.
That was the way I found Sugarman. I was backpacking for 6 months in Africa and South America looking for stories. And it's a very, you know, it's a very nice way of finding stories there, you know, adventure and searching for stuff. It's fun.
I wonder how many times you've been had, and I wonder how many plans have gone bad. Times you had sex, and I wonder, do you know who'll be next? I wonder, wonder I do.